New Zealand announces a phased reopening of its borders, which have been largely closed for 2 years due to the pandemic. Starting February 27, vaccinated New Zealanders can travel home without undergoing facility-based quarantine, while citizens coming from other countries will be able to do so 2 weeks later. But they will still be required to do self-isolation. As for tourists from Australia and other visa-free countries, they will only be allowed entry in July. And by October, travelers from the rest of the world will also be allowed in.
Overall, opening back up in this managed way balances inflows of travellers so people can reunite and fill our workforce shortages, while also ensuring our healthcare system can manage an increase in cases. After all, our strategy with Omicron is to slow the spread, and our borders are a part of that strategy.
New COVID-19 cases in Tokyo exceed 20,000 for the first time, dimming hopes that the Omicron wave has peaked in Japan. Nationwide cases also reached a record 91,760. The closely watched occupancy rate in hospitals edged up to 51.4%. Officials had said a state of emergency would be needed if that figure reached 50%. Tokyo and most of the country are under a quasi-state of emergency until February 13th. A start of a new era for global winter sport. That's how the International Olympic Committee calls the Beijing Winter Olympics, which will officially kick off Friday. The IOC also said the games should be unifying, saying sports and politics do not mix. The comments come as the U.S. and some allied countries stage a diplomatic boycott of this year's games over the human rights situation in China.
Together, we are writing a new chapter in sporting history. Tomorrow, Beijing will become the first city ever to host both summer and winter editions of the Olympic Games. China has already made history by surpassing the goal of engaging 300 million Chinese people with sport on snow and ice. For people who may not know China very well, this figure seemed hardly believable. But we always had confidence because we knew about the Chinese determination, efficiency, and dynamism. Today, we can say China is a winter sport country. I can only reiterate my heartfelt congratulations to our Chinese partners and friends on this extraordinary achievement. It will change the landscape of winter sport around the world forever.
As for Chinese President Xi Jinping, he says the Beijing Winter Olympics will be streamlined, safe, and splendid. As preparations for the Winter Games shift into high gear, more COVID cases are also being recorded. 55 new COVID infections linked to the Games were detected Thursday, the highest daily tally so far. 29 cases were found among new airport arrivals, while the rest were among those in the so-called closed-loop bubble.
So I think we are confident that the system will work, but we will not yet relax, obviously. The one thing we have learned about COVID for 2 years is it always can surprise us. So we keep all the measures in place, we stick with the playbook, and we make sure we remain safe.
News overseas, U.S. President Joe Biden approves the deployment of nearly 3,000 troops to Eastern Europe as diplomatic talks falter over Russia's massive military buildup near Ukraine. Here's the full story.
The Pentagon will send nearly 3,000 more American troops to Eastern Europe in the coming days amid a tense standoff with Russia over Ukraine.
The United States will soon move additional forces to Romania, Poland, and Germany.
Defense Department spokesperson John Kirby said the troops were not going to fight in Ukraine, emphasizing
they're going to ensure the robust defense of our NATO allies.
The deployments are above and beyond the 8,500 troops the Pentagon put on alert last month to be ready to deploy to Europe if needed. And the moves aim to reassure jittery NATO allies nervously watching a massive Russian military buildup near Ukraine while avoiding new deployments to Ukraine itself.
Our commitment to NATO, Article 5, and collective defense remains ironclad.
Efforts to reach a diplomatic solution have faltered in recent weeks, with Western countries describing Russia's main security demands as non-starters and Moscow showing no signs of backing down. Russian President Vladimir Putin spoke about the Ukraine crisis publicly on Tuesday for the first time this year. In his remarks, Putin laid out a worldview in which Russia was the victim, not the aggressor, and that Washington was trying to lure Moscow into war.
His biggest objective here is Ukraine back into the Russian sphere of influence. And the only way he's going to do that is through military means. His calculation is, can he get away with it?
Alexander Vindman is a retired U.S. Army lieutenant colonel and former director of European affairs for the U.S. National Security Council. He told Reuters the U.S. was doing the right thing in bolstering NATO and signaling Russia would pay a price for any aggression. But he said the moves might be too late.
Part of my remaining criticism with the U.S. approach right now is that it's all contingent and reactionary based on what Russia does. We could have done more. We're doing a pretty exceptional job now, later in the game. But I think unfortunately, the die may have been cast.
The Pentagon said it had not ruled out further troop deployments.